I wrote the book because I felt somehow, like many of you, that the story of India's freedom struggle is somehow incomplete. I always felt that. You get the impression from the official story that we Indians politely asked the British to leave and they left. That is not the entire story, unfortunately. There is another story of continuous armed resistance to the British going back to the 18th century. This book deals with the last 50 years of that resistance. And what a story it is of spies, of adventure, of assassination plots, of absolute treachery. So quite apart from any nationalist feeling you may have, it's a fantastic story to read just because of the amazing adventures of these characters and amazing things that they were willing to do.
Very warm welcome on behalf of HarperCollins Publishers to this launch of Sanjeev Sanyal's new book, Revolutionaries, the other story of how India won its freedom. Vande Mataram. May I now request the Honorable Home Minister, Shri Amit Shah Ji, the author, Shri Sanjeev Sanyal, Dr. Sameer Saran, President, Observer Research Foundation, and Anand Padmanabhan, CEO of HarperCollins, to please come on stage.
So let me thank also my cousin, Saurabh Sanyal, for photos and letters of his grandfather and of Rashbehari Bose, Meenal and NMML archive team for helping me discover a box of guns of the revolutionaries, which had been lying around forgotten in the archives here. In that box, incidentally, we found several rifles, bullets, some of which are shown on the cover, by the way, a Mauser pistol and a unexploded bomb, which thankfully we diffused. All of this is now on display in the Biplobi Bharat Museum in Victoria Memorial in Kolkata. I would also like to thank Ashok Pal, He went with me to Nadia in West Bengal, and we traveled across the district to many of the homes of some of these revolutionaries that are there in the book. Big thanks to Savitri Kankoji Soni, a big thanks to her because she introduced me to the world of her father, Pandurang Kankoji, with a remarkable character who was not only a person who was a revolutionary, who fought in many places, of all places, against General Dyer in Persia during the First World War, but is also remarkably the father of the Green Revolution. Finally, let me thank my wife Smita and son Dhruv for putting together the theme song using the third and fourth stanzas of Vande Mataram, which you just heard. As you can imagine, this particular book is quite emotional for me. In many ways, there are stories in here that I have grown up with because, as some of you will realize, several of these characters are related to me directly, either through my mother's or father's side. But that's not the only reason I wrote this book. I wrote the book because I felt somehow, like many of you, that the story of India's freedom struggle is somehow incomplete. I always felt that. You get the impression from the official story that we Indians politely asked the British to leave, and they left. That is not the entire story, unfortunately. There is another story of continuous armed resistance to the British going back to the 18th century. This book deals with the last 50 years of that resistance. And what a story it is, of spies, of adventure, of assassination plots, of absolute treachery. So, quite apart from any nationalist feeling you may have, it's a fantastic story to read just because of the amazing adventures of these characters and amazing things that they were willing to do. Also, I thought it was important because although some of these people who put up this extraordinary resistance to the biggest empire on the planet, these events are, by the way, not a long time ago. These are not ancient events. These are events, some of which happened within living memory. So these names have not been forgotten. People still know the name of Rashbehari Bose or Netaji Subhas Chandra Bose or Bhagat Singh, Ajit Singh, and so on. But the impression you get from reading our textbooks is that they were individual acts of bravery that were somehow unconnected to the wider story. At best, they were a side story got in the way of the main movement, which was the passive movement of nonviolent resistance. Unfortunately, that is not the story you come across when you begin to actually dig through the archives, look at the conversations that the British themselves were having, and of course the conversations that was happening in the public discourse at that time. The revolutionaries were very much a part of public discourse, of the thinking of the British intelligence of that time. And then, even to understand the Indian National Congress itself, you need the story of the revolutionaries. In fact, the Indian National Congress had lots of different streams, which included, by the way, many of these revolutionaries. They were powerful enough inside the Congress that Netaji Subhas Bose was able to win an open election against the Gandhians. And of course, it's a different matter that he was later on pushed out through backroom channels. But the fact is that even within the Congress, the revolutionaries were able to hold their own. And this sort of story of the revolutionary resistance, unfortunately, was almost deliberately suppressed after independence. The reason for that is not far to seek. Almost all the senior members of the revolutionary movement were dead by this point in time. Whether it's Rashbehari Bose or Sachindra Nath Sanyal or Bismil, Netaji had gone missing or dead, depending on your belief. The fact is, when India became independent, there was no revolutionary leader of stature who could kind of be a part of the conversation. And as a result, a particular stream of the Congress party took power And perhaps it's human that they would emphasize their own role. In itself, this is not wrong. But what I think is wrong is that there seems to have been a deliberate attempt to erase the memory of many of these greats who gave their lives and everything in order to make sure that we enjoy the freedoms we do today. Historians like R.C. Majumdar, for example, who had been originally given the job of writing the official history of India's freedom struggle, he was evicted when he began to talk about these other streams of history. Moreover, it is important to remember that the revolutionaries were not just doing their little bit. They were linked to peasant movements like the Ekav movement led by Madari Pasi. They were linked to tribal revolts like those led by Aluri Sitarama Raju, now made famous by RRR. But a person, again, much forgotten till this movie came along. So this is a much larger story. Unfortunately, independent India did not give them their due credit. The soldiers of the INA, the sailors of the naval revolt of 1946 were not taken back into the Navy and Army after independence. They were not even recognized for decades as being freedom fighters. It's only very recently that they were given a recognition, and it's only 2 years ago that for the very first time that INA veterans were actually taken for a parade. The few that are still alive today were taken for a parade down the Republic Day, down Kartavya Marg, then called Rajpath. So this book really is my humble tribute to this extraordinary effort all these people did. This was a big effort involving tens of thousands of people, not only within India, but across the world. The revolutionaries had networks in Germany, in Japan, in North America, in Ireland, in Singapore, and many of the streams of our national consciousness to this day derive from the revolutionaries, even if you do not know this. And this is across the political spectrum, whether it is the CPI or the RSP on the left or the RSS on the right and many streams of the Congress in between. Many of them have their origins in this revolutionary movement. It is even true, incidentally, of those who oppose India. Not many of you may realize that the Khalistani movement has its origins in the British attempt to subvert the Gadarites. So some of you may have wondered, why is it that the Khalistani movement is based so much in Canada? Well, it is because the North American Sikhs were very much a part of the Gadarite revolutionary movement, and they used to operate through a network of gurudwaras, which were then infiltrated by the British intelligence officer called Hopkinson. And large amount of money was spent in trying to separate the Sikhs from the Hindus and from the revolutionaries. And in a court in Canada, Hopkinsons were shot dead by a Gadarite called Mewa Singh. Now, I'm quite certain there almost nobody in this audience who actually has heard of Mewa Singh. But Mewa Singh actually shot dead Hopkinson back in, I think it was 1914 or 1915. So there are all these interesting characters in this book. I hope some of you will enjoy it. And I look forward to your feedback. Thank you very much.
When the Home Minister was talking about the Junoon, it struck me that whether I discussed telecom policy with you, the economic survey with you, the drone policy with you, you always have that India first and India must do something approach. So when was Sanjeev Sanyal's Junoon born? When you were 6, 5, 8, 9? When did you see it becoming an essential part of your person?
As far as right now is concerned, I truly believe, like perhaps many of you do, and I know you do it certainly, that this is our moment in the sun. If you read my very first book, it's called The Indian Renaissance, India's Rise After 1,000 Years of Decline. So I was writing this, by the way, more than 15 years ago, in round about 2005. So 17 years ago. So you can imagine that the thing that really began to almost claw at me is the fact that, you know, we may have been a great civilization, but for so long, we were in this phase of decline. And finally, we begin to see the glimmer of hope. So this is 15, 16, 17 years ago. And I think I'm beginning to feel even better about that idea now. We genuinely can see this energy. It's there, whether it's in industry, it's on the sports field. I mean, India has never been thought of as a great sporting country, but you see it there. You see in the extraordinary explosion of all kinds of literature that is now coming out. So I think this is our moment in the sun. So I'm making my little contribution to the cause in a sense. But your question was a slightly different one.
Correct.
What is it back in my childhood maybe that may have caused me to have this view of the world? And the reason for this, I think, is because I actually came from a state that in some ways went the other way. Bengal was at the cutting edge of much of what is there in this book. You'll see Bengal is everywhere in this book. It provided the inspiration in terms of the song Vande Mataram, Sri Aurobindo, the Audishanan Samiti, all of this, Netaji, Vivekanand, all of them were Bengalis. And yet I grew up in the Kolkata of the 70s and 80s, and all that spirit was somehow almost been deliberately extinguished. I mean, Kolkata did not die. It was murdered, and I'm a witness to that murder. So at some point in time, I began to develop this very strong view that how could a people who triggered this massive movement, led to, triggering national feeling, modern India is almost created by Bengalis, and here we are in 1980s Kolkata run by Jyoti Basu, and it's completely stuck like this. So it sort of in some ways very deep down created this determination that you need to reignite this spirit again. And so it began to spread. I came to Delhi and then, of course, lived many places in the world. And it came to me that this spirit is something that is not, it's something that can be ignited, that somebody has to put in that effort. And if I can make a small contribution to that cause, so be it.
No, I'll come to that point. That's a very important point. Our own assessment of our histories has a lot to do with our postures today, and I'll come to that point. I think that's important, something that comes out of this book. Let me go back to what I felt when I was reading it. I felt Sanjeev Sanyal was actually narrating this story to me, and I could also sense some expression of satisfaction in certain spaces, a disappointment in certain words. I could actually see you very intimately connected with the words that were written here. And of course, you explained why, because you had family history connections, and of course, also archives from them that have been reflected in this book. But tell me, does this give you the satisfaction of having completed a certain journey, something that began many years ago as a child? And perhaps this book captures a much longer arc of something that may have been inside of you and expressed through a book like this.
So as you mentioned, many of these stories I heard as a child, because my mother's and father's family were both very closely associated with the freedom struggle and specifically with the revolutionary movement. But I wasn't fully conscious of the importance of many of the things that I heard about. So it may, many of the characters that I mentioned in the book were still alive, by the way, in the 1980s. So in my teens, I actually knew them, like my great-grandfather, Nalinaksha Sanyal, who is in the book. But somehow, at that time, all these pieces didn't really fit together. It's about a decade or a little more than a decade ago when I began to actually research the book that many of these gnawing things in my head, which used to gnaw at me, began to finally fit together. So in some ways, while many of these things are bits and pieces that I knew or bits and pieces I found while researching my other books, it's only when I began to write this book that they actually began to fit together. So in some ways, it was in many ways a discovery of India of my own kind, so to speak, where I began to discover much later on how these pieces fit together. So let me give you an example. In my 20s, I used to live in Mumbai, in Colaba. And there is a small shrine, almost you can call it, to the 1946 naval revolt. Now, I'd never actually heard of the naval revolt till that point. So I just bump into this thing, a small shrine, and it says, you know, 1946 naval revolt. Now, I asked people in Mumbai about it. Almost nobody else in Mumbai seemed to know anything else about this. This is extraordinary. This is in Mumbai 1990s. Today, of course, it's easier. I would have Googled it up, but in the 90s, you couldn't do it. So it really gnawed at me that, look, this must have been a very major event. So as I researched it, and I discovered, oh my God, this is a critical moment in our history, because it's during this revolt that Attlee decided to set up the Cabinet Committee on Indian Independence in 1946. This is the critical moment, and yet we know nothing about it. So in a sense, I had somewhere an angst that somehow our story didn't fit together. So it's only when I began researching this book that I began to find all these pieces and kind of be able to sew them together.
There's also something very interesting you say right up front in the book, and then I'm going to come to pretty much the end of the book as well. Up front, you suggest that there seemed perhaps a symbiotic, or at least a synchronous or an asynchronous relationship between both the violent and the revolutionaries and their determination to seek freedom, and the nonviolent Gandhian determination. In your assessment, was that an adjustment, or was there any deliberate ploy to maintain two tracks? Would that be a stretch of imagination, or was that only tolerance at most from the mainstream for the revolutionaries, or as they were called, extremists at that time?
See, for the purposes of a book, one talks about two streams, but in fact, it's a spectrum. There were people who were in the who were full-time revolutionaries with armed revolt. Then there were their sympathizers. There were some who had been a sympathizer and moved to becoming actual revolutionaries. There were revolutionaries who moved towards the thing. You're talking about a Congress which was a big tent. There were all, of course, the loyalists. There were also the nationalists. There were many people in between. Different people did different things at different points in time. So, for example, you have the Swarajists. Now, the Swarajists are, of course, the descendants of the nationalists or extremists, depending on what you call them. But Motilal Nehru actually was a member of that Swarajist group for a period of time. Of course, he then drifted away. So, there were many things going on here. You can't put exact, sort of, certainly not from today's perspective, put them in neat boxes. So, for example, again, ideologically, if you, many of those who we would now consider to the right were considered then to belong to the left. Many of those who belong to the left were actually inspired by people from the right. So, I'll take Bhagat Singh, for example, who is very often, you know, example of early communist working for Indian freedom. But in fact, as he writes in his own writings, he was almost the only Marxist in an entirely non-Marxist movement. In fact, but his inspiration, which was Sachindra Nath Sanyal, and he writes it very clearly in Why I'm an Atheist, his inspiration, Sachindra Sanyal, was vehemently anti-Marxist. Hmm. And similarly, even within the other streams, you find, for example, you have communists and Marxists. There, one branch of them very much get almost captured, you can say, by the British Marxists, like Rajni Pal Medat. But then there are other Marxists who remain quite suspicious of both the Russians and the British. And they end up in something called the Anushilan Marxists. And much later on, they then become a party called the RSP, the Revolutionary Socialist Party. It barely exists today. It, I think, has just one MP. But once upon a time, it was a rather powerful party. So there were all these mix and match stuff. And even within the Congress, the revolutionaries, when they came together, were very capable of beating the Gandhians, even in an open election, as Netaji himself demonstrated.
So, I just want to take the point that you made in your intervention and something that I read in the book, pretty much towards the end of the book. And this is something I had no clue about. So I must confess, this was the first time I encountered something like this. You suggest in the early part that much of the tall figures of revolutionaries were no longer present at the time of independence, and hence their role and perhaps even their place in our history could be diminished because of the pen belonged to the others who were writing history at that time. But you mentioned something which surprised me. You said, if all the revolutionaries were dead, why did Jinnah celebrate the army, the members of the INA or the members of the armed rebellions, and actually mainstream them into Pakistan, while we took pretty much 25 odd years or 20 plus years to acknowledge their existence? What was the difference? Revolutionaries were missing on both sides at the time of independence.
So one of the great ironies of history is that when you have the INA soldiers, they were at independence, they were not incorporated into the Indian Army, and neither were the sailors of the Royal Indian Navy revolt. But this was not true of Pakistan. The Pakistanis actually incorporated many of the INA soldiers and officers into their army. And in fact, the attack on Kashmir in 1947-48 involved many former INA officers, including General Kiani, who was at some point a number two in the INA. So there are many such interesting characters that were there. So that is why I will have to sadly say that in India, there was a definite, deliberate attempt to suppress this line of history. And you cannot escape this, you know, whether it's, you know, removing R.C. Mazumdar from the chairmanship of the official history writing, or, for example, very almost, what should I say, vicious things. Many people may not realize that the cellular jail, today it may be a national monument, but it was almost entirely pulled down. Many of the sites relating to the revolutionaries after independence were systematically actually wiped out. I'll give you one example right here in Delhi. MAMSI, which is Maulana Azad Medical College, it used to be the site of a jail where many of these revolutionaries were hanged. And so in the 1950s, the revolutionaries demanded that you turn at least the area where the gallows were into a national monument. Mm. And the government of that time actually agreed to this. But then sadly what happens is that just a few years later, the whole place is converted into a medical college, and they specifically go out of the way of demolishing the gallows area and building something on it.
You know, a quick question to you, because you mentioned the change in the authors who wrote our history post-independence. And someone who got to know that I was going to be talking to you told me, you must ask Sanjeev. I'm in government, I can't ask him, but please ask Sanjeev. That isn't it time to remove government from the task of writing history and to promote historians and individuals and writers who perhaps write competing stories, but at least lead to a wholesome narrative of how complex those periods were, something that you mentioned in your book as well.
Well, I work for the government, but my history writing is
a private
activity. But let me say that absolutely, I think there has to be a much wider effort. But yes, there is a role for the government, in particularly in the case of school textbooks. There has to be some standardization. While you can allow extra books to be there, but some standardization has to be there in government textbooks. So therefore, that is an area where the government will play a role of some sort.
Well, you know,
Gautam, and similarly with national monuments and things like that.
Gautam Chikrame told me that if he had read your book and gone and attempted a school exam, he would have failed. Because it would have been out of syllabus.
The UPSC exam.
I mean, that's just an aside. We were just having a conversation on school type. So there's something, again, which is counterintuitive. You know, if you look at modern movements where we are seeking self-determination or separatisms or any form of extremist activities, people tend to revert to their more primal selves. Turn to religion, turn to customs, turn conservative, turn fundamentalist, and you've seen this happening across the world. You suggest in your book that actually the revolutionaries were reformists, were seeking a modern society, were not taking India back, but were taking the society forward. Now, this is slightly counterintuitive in terms of the modern day examples if you look at these such movements. What was driving this modernist approach, even as they sought revolutionary change?
So here there is something that we need to understand. They were both modernists and, in many cases, religious revivalists at the same time. And this is very important to understand this. You have to understand that if you're dealing with the late 19th century, you've had a country that's now been in occupation for quite some time under British rule. There is many impulses for modernizing, culturally modernizing. Of course, everybody knows about the earlier efforts of Rajaram Mohan Roy, Vidya Sagar, etc. But there were, and many of them were somewhat westernizing efforts as well. But there were other modernizing efforts too, led by the likes of, for example, Rani Rashmani, who built the Dakshineshwar temple. And what you have here is this train culminates in the figures such as Swami Vivekananda, in particular him, but also Sri Aurobindo himself. Now, if you read their writings, it's quite interesting. They are both very, very proudly Hindu, unapologetic Hindus. This is also true of Sachindra Nath Sanyal, of Savarkar, of Tilak, many of the other, Bismil, and so on. And in every single case, however, they are also modernists, because they are also trying to reform an ancient civilization
and its
religious practices and philosophy and so on. So they are also modernizers at the same time. So it is very critical here to understand, first of all, the fact that they were unapologetic Hindus should not be suggested that they are somehow bigots. For example, Savarkar's, in fact, in many of these cases, their nearest lieutenant was not a Hindu.
Correct.
So, for example, Savarkar's most important lieutenant in his early years was Madam Bhikaji Kama. Bismil was very much he was much into the Shuddhi movement. He was a strong Arya Samaji and so on. But his closest lieutenant is Ashfaqullah Khan. Tilak, the person who revived the Ganpati festival as a way of political mobilization, Joseph Baptiste is his closest ally. So they were unapologetic Hindus. They were modernizers. But at the same time, they were not bigots. I mean, I think the problem here is that we try to put people into these boxes, which is convenient to today's debates. At that time, there were many other things going on. There were some people who were nationalists and Marxists at the same time. Bhagat Singh being a good example.
Please read the book and you will find that in the spectrum of revolutionaries and their associates, you will find a kind of a secular array of individuals who were, of course, using their communities and their traditions as a basis of mobilization, of motivation, but still modernizing. And it was across religions you saw this tendency, and your book in some sense illuminates that. So I think this is something that this book contributes, which I got to learn from it. Now, there's another very interesting nugget in your book, and this is pretty much towards the end of it, towards the second half of it. It's the iron plaque being worn by Savarkar in jail, with mentioned 1960, as a taunt that he's going to be there forever. And of course, it is also in many ways a sign of how cruel or how many of our freedom fighters, revolutionaries, were treated at that time. When we look back, why are we so obsessed with what I was mentioning to some others was tactical apologies or tactical repentance? Get out and attack them again. Say sorry, go out, attack them again. Your book narrates this. Why are we so obsessed with having this perfect, unified example of behavior, not understanding that battles had to be won and you had to fight another day? Why is it that we wanted the saint and the revolutionary in the same person?
In fact, it made no sense, even if he were a saint, to continue in jail. And since Savarkar is an extremely politically divisive figure today, let me use another character who did similar things as well, Sachindra Nath Sanyal. Sachindra Nath Sanyal was involved with Rashbehari Bose in trying to create this great insurrection in the First World War in the Indian Army. He was nearly succeeded, by the way, but it failed anyway. He was stuck in jail from 1915 to 1920. At 1920, he, like Savarkar, also wrote an apology letter, and he was released because of part of the amnesty after Jallianwala Bagh. He comes out, he promptly goes back to doing what he was doing before. And it is he who recruited the next generation of freedom fighters. Bismil, Ashfaqullah Khan, Bhagat Singh, Chandrashekhar Azad, Rajguru, Sukhdev Thapar, all of these characters, Master Das, Surjo Sen, all of these people are his recruits. He then founds the Hindustan Republican Association. As the Honorable Minister was mentioning, he writes for the first time clearly that India, after independence, should become a democratic republic based on universal suffrage. So all of this he did only because he wrote that apology letter and came out. Now, it's a different matter that after a while the British understood what he was doing, stuck him back in jail after the Kakudi case. 1925, he goes back to jail. 1927, he's sent back to Kalapani. He stays 10 years in Kalapani. Then in 1937, writes another letter, comes out. Then guess what he does? He goes and begins working with Subhas Bose and Rashbehari Bose and working against the working with the Japanese. So people don't realize that Subhas Bose and Rashbehari Bose were in touch with each other and with the Japanese before the Second World War had started, and they were already planning stuff. And so he does this. Subhas Bose, of course, escapes. Sachin Sanyal is stuck back into jail. And of course, he dies in 1942. But what I'm trying to say is, here is a person who keeps writing these letters, keeps coming out, keeps going and does exactly what he was doing. The British also know what he is doing, that he's going to do this. But that's the game they were playing. For the fact that he was writing these letters is surely meaningless to, and the language he used, you know, your obedient servant, hardly suggests that Sachindra Nath Sanyal was particularly obedient or a servant.
Correct. Why is it when, you know, and that struck me when the Honorable Home Minister was speaking, why is it that when the entire country, as he mentioned, and perhaps, you know, we have to be in many ways looking at the times at that time, the size of the country, how difficult communication was, how difficult in getting information across to each other was, if the entire country mourned the hanging of Bhagat Singh, as he mentioned. Why is it that in 1947, when India was rejoicing in freedom, we were not able to build that moment of celebrating this, the other story, of celebrating, you know, the story would never have been another story had we had that ability as a nation to celebrate at that time, these revolutionaries as well. What was missing? What did we lack in not being able to rouse the sentiments and passions of all the people who were celebrating freedom at last? And why were these left?
So, as I mentioned even earlier, and the Honorable Minister also mentioned, there were many aspects to this. One of them, of course, was that many of these, you know, basically the leadership of the revolutionary movement had been killed or had died from various causes by the time 1947 came. So they weren't around at the time that it happened. Consequently, not in a position to provide the kind of, or be participant in the political transition that may have otherwise been if they had been there. If Netaji had been there, he would definitely have been an important character on the transition, or Rashbehari Bose or any of the others. So the first and simple problem was the revolution. The tall figures were simply missing at the time that independence happened. And in many cases, simply been brutally killed. So that was one part of the problem. The other part of the problem was, you have to remember where much of this revolutionary movement was happening. While it was happening in every part of the country, that the two, three places where it was real hotbeds, one was Bengal, particularly eastern Bengal. The other was Punjab. And the third was Maharashtra, particularly among Maharashtrian Brahmins. Now, what happens in 1947-48? Partition. The same people who had been fighting for independence, you know, giving up their lives, giving everything up, suddenly find independence happens, but their own homes are lost to partition, they fall on the wrong side. Happened to, you know, my own mother's family. They fell in Kushtia, which is, in fact, just a few kilometers across on the wrong side of the border. So they fell on the wrong side of the border, became revolutionaries, became refugees. Happened in Punjab as well, and many people in this audience may well have had families who faced this problem. Maharashtra did not, however, face partition. However, their story is also pretty sad. While all communities in Maharashtra did participate in this, the Maharashtrian Brahmins had been very much at the leading cutting edge of this, partly because they had this memory of the Maratha Empire and so on. Now, what happens is that the British had throughout been investing heavily in anti-Brahminism in Maharashtra specifically. And at independence, of course, just a few months after independence, Mahatma Gandhi gets assassinated by a Maharashtrian Brahmin. So there is this huge outpouring of grief by the so-called Gandhians, who then go on a rampage, and there are huge riots across Maharashtra in which the Brahmins are targeted. Hundreds upon hundreds are killed. Thousands of houses are burned down, a matter that was never investigated, and to this day there's a hush-hush about this whole thing, to this day. Just to give an example, Savarkar's younger brother, Narayan Savarkar, was stoned to death on the streets of Mumbai. Mahatma Gandhi's assassination was a sad thing. Somebody was hanged for it. We have no idea who did it to Narayan Savarkar. Nobody has ever been nothing has ever been investigated, and certainly nobody has been hanged for it. And so this is a sad fact, that this is what happened to those communities who had fought for independence. This didn't end even there. East Bengal Hindus were, of course, thrown out of their homes, but it didn't happen in one shot in 1947. They went through a second genocide in 1971. Millions of them came into India as refugees. And many of them then, in 1979, faced the Morijhapi massacre. Depends on how many people you think, somewhere between 4 and 10,000 people were massacred by Jyoti Basu's government in Morijhapi in Bengal. These same refugees. 1984, riots. The Sikhs, who had been at the forefront of the revolutionary movement, again, were attacked and killed mercilessly on the streets of even this city. So the communities that had been at the forefront of the revolutionary movement, and I'm sorry to say, were not merely ignored, they were actively persecuted in modern India.
Sanjeev, you're a policy person who's been in negotiation discussions. There was a book one of our foreign secretaries had produced, The Long Game, where he spoke about India-China negotiations. In fact, a few days ago, I called him up after reading the book, and I asked him to recant his conversation with me. He mentioned that when India and China negotiated, on one side was Mao's diplomats, battle-hardened, having won their country. Pao Mao himself was a commissar for the PLA, and they were coming in triumphant after having liberated and fought him. And on the other hand, we had negotiators who had seen non-violence as the means of independence, who had seen negotiations as a way of outcomes, and there was a kind of there were two different actors sitting on the table with two different skill sets. Do you think incomplete storytelling about a past has affected our ability to sometimes...
Absolutely. And in fact, you brought up a very important issue. The people on our side were not merely those who had been a part of the nonviolent movement. In fact, there would have been very few of them. At least they had put up some fight. The bulk of our negotiators actually were civil servants who had collaborated with the British. So that is the more interesting story.
And you do mention it here.
Yes. In fact, since we have the vice chief of the Navy, he'll corroborate with me. The first Indian naval chief only happened in 1958. So for the first few decades, the negotiation was being done by either collaborators
or
in some cases the British, who were collaborating on our behalf with the Chinese. So forget about battle-hardened, scarred Chinese generals or whatever, politicians pushing back against us. We were not even represented by the people who won our freedom, including those who were involved in the non-violent movement.
Oh, thank you. My name is Kirti Vasan. I had a question on 1946 revolt. War like 1857, the first revolution that we had, the War of Independence, it took them nearly 10 to 12 years to plan it out. And every war is like well planned. In 1946, it somehow happens that every single ship in India, British, Indian Army and Navy is revolting against them. But somehow it seems to be, there is no nervous center controlling it. How did that message pass through? How did they plan it and so well, and they were holding out Mumbai for so many days? So is there a, was there a core committee which was working on it? Was, how did that happen? Like, it doesn't come through in, even in you, in the new history video channels or things.
Yeah. So keep the, there is an element of the random in a revolt. So it's not like somebody was planning the exact revolt of the naval revolt of 1946. But it had been building up for a very long time. And as I said, the Rashbehari Bose and Sachin Sanyal had attempted in the First World War. Then Rashbehari and Netaji attempted it and succeed partially with INA in the Second World War. And then when the revolt of 1946 happens, it's not planned in that sense, but clearly the case that there was all of this stuff that was bubbling. Remember, at the same time, the INA trials are going on. So you can imagine the mood. And the wider context also you need to take into account. Do remember that the war has finished. All the British, Australian, American soldiers have all gone back home. They have been demobilized. They don't want to hang around. So who controls all these so-called liberated countries? The British Indian Army. The British Indian Army at that point held Egypt, Indonesia, Burma, Singapore, Malaysia, even Vietnam was held by Indian soldiers. Now, this is the context in which this revolt is taking place. The British are genuinely scared that if this revolt happens, suddenly the Indians will end up with this gigantic empire. And you have in Indonesia, for example, the Dutch trying to get in there, the Indonesian sort of rebels or whatever you may, nationalists fighting against them, and the Indian British Indian Army being sent to quell them, in which many Indonesians died, but also hundreds of Indian soldiers died. So the Indian soldiers were on the verge of a massive revolt, and the Allied forces were very scared that not only would they revolt, but remember they also have under them at that time tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of Japanese soldiers who had only just surrendered and were fully trained. So it was only a matter of handing them some guns and get on with it. So this is the extremely wobbly conditions. And mind you, there are all these rumors that Netaji is still alive and so on. So this is the wider context. So it's not so much the step-by-step planning that matters, but the mahal, so to speak, was certainly an important part of what was going on in 1946 when the naval revolt took place.
I feel I'm in the newsroom asking you a question, but I have two, three important questions, sub-questions. And please accept my congratulations for this absolutely marvelous book, much needed for the country. My first question is, jaise Honorable HM ne aaj baat ki, Bharat ki satrangi sabhyata se Jai Hind ka nara sunai deta hai, but hamari jo kitabe hai, my two questions are, why is Ahimsa so central to India's worldview, A, and why are we only talking of losing battles? Battle of Vandivash, Battle of Buxar, 1764, 1760. We all know it by rote. My children know it by rote. All of us know that. What about the Cholas? What about the battles we have won, which we are not talking about? So I think this is a very important step, and we must make Gen X aware and millennia aware of how many people, I mean, including.
So let me say that there are two parts to your question, but I think the bigger question that you ask is that our history that we learn in our textbooks, at least, is very peculiar. You have here a long history that is in where no matter when the battle happens, the Indians lose. Wo battle of Buxar ho, Indians lose. Battle of Plassey ho, Indians lose. The three battles of Panipat, Indians lose. Now, my question, which I've been asking for many years, is surely, if we are still around, we must have won some battles, even by chance. So I began to investigate this matter. In fact, this is a conversation I had some years ago with another writer, Vikram Sampath, who went on to investigate the matter and actually has written a book about it, a very nice book about it. But the basic point is this. Once we began to investigate the matter, we discovered that actually Indians won lots of battles. It's just that it's not there in our history books. Now, I understand that a colonial power that was ruling over this would edit them out. And it's done beautifully. I have to credit colonial era historians for this. You get the impression from our history that the Mughals ruled us, then a few years later the British ruled us. The fact is that in between there was an 80-year period where the Marathas ruled most of India. Now, 80 years is not short. The Indian Republic has still not existed for 80 years. And they ruled from Attock all the way to Thanjavur. So it's, and they, you know, the Peshwa Bajirao II ruled more of India than Akbar did. And yet, you barely learn anything about them. In fact, the only reason you hear about Bajirao is because of that movie called Mastani, which is actually, you know, almost, you know, trivializes his life. So this editing out happened, which fair enough. If you are a colonial power, you will do this. Question is, why after independence did we want this narrative to be there? And so here, very much important part of this has got to be two things. One is, we have now talked quite a lot about one stream of the Congress that came to power. It's not all the streams of Congress, but one particular stream of Congress that came to power, then naturally wanted to exaggerate their own importance. They may have also gone ahead and also deliberately diminished the roles of others. But the question is, why about the longer history? And there, my investigation suggests that it has a lot to do with the fact that those who wrote our history, in fact, you look at an entire intellectual class after independence for the first two generations, large proportion of them had been collaborators of the British. So it was very important in a sense for their own story to themselves maybe, to suggest that India was not a country before 1947. So all of these people were consequently not important, and this old story had to be continued, because otherwise they were going to say that we had been traitors. So in order to kind of justify their own treachery and their own collaboration, it was important to them that India had not been a country put together before 1947. And so they perpetuated these colonial era stories. So it is, I mean, this is quite astounding. I mean, I'll give you the example. One example I do mention in the book is a famous Hindi writer called Yashpal. He's literally the, after Premchand, he's the second most important Hindi writer. And he made his name, ironically, by talking about his role in the freedom struggle, much of which was made up. Because we now know that he was actually a police informer. He was the almost certainly the source of information based on which Chandrashekhar Azad was trapped in Allahabad and killed. But Yashpal then became, after independence, the greatest writer of Hindi language. So not surprisingly, he uses pulpit to tell a particular story. And this you see with many of the others. You scratch a little bit and you will find that they were direct descendants of the Imperial Police Service officials, informers or contractors and so on, who had deliberately and actively collaborated with the British.